Hello, I am Maximiliano Fortman, a mobile web developer and author. I have created this course on progressive web apps to help you deliver web apps without the need of an app store. In this course, we will see how to make your web app installable on mobile and desktop devices, as well as make it offline capable, create a PWA, and leverage the power of the web platform beyond the browser.
So it's just an index.html, nothing too fancy. We have a UL that has a list and a form, and then app.js that is listening for DOM content loaded, adding some event listeners, and rendering nodes. That seems so fancy. What I need, this is important, because remember that I mentioned that the PWA criteria needs HTTPS. And you say, well, that might be a problem if we want to run this locally. There is one exception to that rule. It's localhost. If you're running on localhost, you don't need HTTPS, and you can still pass the PWA criteria. But also means localhost, and exactly localhost, not your IP address. 127.0, no. Not the name of your computer, no. Exactly localhost, okay? So that means we need a server. So we need to serve this web app with a server, okay? So if you're a web developer, you probably know how to do that. I have a plugin to do that. Called library load, or if you don't have a plugin, if you have Node.js installed, you can execute npx serve. Npx serve will just create a server on the current folder, and yeah, you can just directly open localhost 3000. So this is how it looks like. I mean, I can add things like add worship. I can go and get some lunch. So I just take some notes. Nothing really fancy, I can delete the notes. And you can see I don't have the icon to install here. I have a Zoom icon, bookmark, but not the install one. And if I'm going to save and share, I have the install page as app. The other one was kind of different, was actually saying the name of my app, install Codepath Master, for example. And that is because I don't have the minimum that I need to make this work. Okay, so I'm missing one piece. Do we have any other place where I can actually check that I'm missing that piece? Yes. And that's going to be our best friend while developing PWAs is DevTools. So I need to open DevTools, and I need to work with the application tab. That's going to be our best friend. In fact, I encourage you to, you can drag on these tabs. I'm not sure if you know this, but I encourage you to drag application and typically put it after console. So elements, console, application, because we will work with applications a lot. An application has a lot of sections. The first one is a manifest. Actually, this is the one that will tell you if you're passing the criteria or not. And you can see that we start seeing a lot of errors saying, hey, you installability, the page has no manifest. We have an error here. So we basically, it's not a PWA. Okay, we have that thing there. Another way to know if you're a PWA or not is if you use Lighthouse. Lighthouse, it lets you create a report on your web app. Probably you have used it for performance because it was pretty useful there. And you can analyze the current page. And you can see that when you create a report here, you can specify the sections. I will unselect all of them, and I will select Progressive Web App. There is a section on making a report on progressive web app. So it will tell you how good or bad are you right now as a progressive web app. So if I analyze the page load, it will reload the page and do some tests. And, well, there are yellows there. By the way, it's saying that this is going to be deprecating the feature because now they're changing the criteria, but anyway, it's still there. If we have a green checkmark here, it means we are. We don't have the green, we are not a PWA. And here, it gives us all the problems that we have. Actually, we have nothing. Okay, well, the only thing that we have is the meta viewport tag. It's the only thing that says, oh yeah, you have one at least. But we are not a PWA, okay? So we need to move one step further. So this is how the manifest looks like. Now we are going to write our own manifest, okay? Going to VS Code now, I'm going to create a file. So I will, the file can have any name, okay? But I typically will call this app.webmanifest. VS Code now automatically recognizes the extension. So now you can see at the bottom, it's turning on the JSON parser by default. So it knows where we are. And also it lets us start writing things. So first, this is important. And actually you won't find this reference in a lot of places. You should start always with an ID property. The ID property was added, it was probably 3 years ago, which means, and not every PWA developer realized that it's there. And I will explain what happened, why it appeared in a sec. And but now it's used by Chrome, and also it's used by Safari on the Mac and iOS. The ID is just what you think, an app ID. But the idea is to put a string there that should be unique within your origin. I don't need to say, oh, this is going to be code path masters. I don't need to do that because if I'm going to publish this on a domain, that will be my domain. So it should be an ID within my domain. So most of the time, if you will have only one PWA, sometimes it's a pattern these days to use a forward slash. Saying, okay, that's a PWA for that. But for this, going back to the soda machines, it can be just soda forward slash 267. That's the ID of that soda machine. So each soda machine will have a different ID. We now have the ID. So you can have your own start URL. And in the start URL, you can add as many parameters and arguments you want. And you can change those arguments, like from... You can change those arguments in the future without any problem, knowing that you have an ID and the ID is not changing. Because remember, different IDs will trigger different PWA installations. Okay, make sense? Why do we need a start URL? That's the next question. Think about this. Let's go back to the Starbucks PWA. I'm in order. I mean, let's go to hot teas and I select chai tea latte. So what happens if I install the app? In fact, you can see this here. If I install the app here, do I want to install the chai tea latte as my homepage? No, right? So I want to install the whole app, not the current URL. So that's why, no matter where you are, when you start a PWA, you decide the URL that you want to use as your start URL, not matter from where it was installed. Another important thing is a scope. Most of the time, a scope, ID, and start URL, they start as the same value. What's the scope? The idea is that everything, the scope is a path within your origin. Everything that, if you make a link, if you open another page, another HTML, if it's out of the scope, it will trigger an inner browser. We will see that in a second in action. If it's within the scope, it will treat it as part of your app, so it will be rendered there. If you don't define the scope, it will take the current folder. That, yeah, if everything is in the root, it will work anyway, but it's important to specify explicitly, yeah, I do have a scope. Then the other important two are name and short name. By the way, in this JSON, we will always use underscore as a way to separate words. The name is the name of your app. And it can be a long name. For example, I can call this, this is the CodePath Masters, the best notepad for your device. So what's the problem with that name? It's too long for an icon, for the name that appears in the icon. But it might be okay for the alt tab, for the tag switcher, for this when you are searching the app, okay? But not for the icon. So that's why we have a short name where we can say, I don't know, CodePath Master, maybe even CodePath Master doesn't fit. So a good rule, it depends on the device. It's difficult to give you a one rule, but typically 11 characters is safe anywhere. Also, it depends on the font size of the user, but 11 characters is okay. More than 11 characters, it might not fit. But you can say, I don't know, CM or CodePad M or whatever. You pick your option. Okay? So if I just say this, I'm still not a progressive web app because there is one more property that is the most important property that I have just said that says display. And I said I need to set the value as standalone. In a couple of minutes, we will see all the possible values for that thing. But that's the one that says, hey, I want to be in a standalone app. So I need to go to my HTML, typically in the head. You don't need to, but typically it goes there. We are going to add the rel manifest pointing to that file. If not, it's not going to work. Okay. It's not like the fab icon that it looks by default for a file with a name, no. So you have to link it explicitly. So after doing that, let's go back here. I need to refresh, reload, so it should get it. And I can try again, add to the home screen, and now you can see a difference. I see CodePad M. So it's kind of reading my manifest. I don't have an icon, so by default, these days, iOS is just using your theme color, and because I don't have a theme color, it's just black by default, and a letter with the initial of your title, of the app's name. By default, now we have, in browsers, non-safe areas. That I'm not sure if you have encountered this before as a web developer, because while you are working in the browser, you don't care about this, because the browser interface takes care of that. But now look at, now we are the app. We are a standalone app. We need to care about that. Look at this at the bottom. Let me do this so we can see it. I have a button here, learn, that opens actually frontendmaster.com. And you can see that it opens in a browser because it's a different scope, okay? So I'm still in the CodePad M app, but I have like an inner browser there. So it happens on Android and iOS and desktop. But I have a problem when, let's reload the app, oops, at the bottom. You can see that that button is on top of that line that is actually part of the gesture. And it's not just a visual problem. It's actually a clickable area problem. There is a whole area here that is not actually clickable. So the user won't be able to touch there. Does it make sense? So I need to somehow move that. And we can do that with CSS environmental variables. So there are some constants available with M function, safe area insert top, right, bottom, left. So we can apply that to. You need to find the HTML element, the selector that you want to apply this to. Okay, makes sense? And that happens also at the left and right when you are in landscape. So you need to find a container and apply this. So we need to go here and find, when you go to the index.html, I have a form, I have a toolbar, I have a node. I can apply maybe to the body first and then start playing with this. So I just copy and paste. I think you have it also in the snippets to copy and paste. So then this is, by the way, this is just one margin, okay? One margin declaration. There is no comma here. So the colon is at the end. You are defining the four margins. Also, what happens with is every browser supporting that? Well, what happens if there is no safe area? For example, if you open this in the browser, browsers typically don't have the safe problem. This has to do with mobile devices, with rounded corners and things like that. The margin will be zero. And maybe you don't want zero. You want a minimum. Okay, I want a minimum margin. So then you can apply a second argument that is the default value. And what happens if a browser doesn't support safe areas? It's not common these days, but then you provide two margin declarations. I'm not sure if you know this in CSS, it's a CSS rule. You can put two values and the browser will take the last one that has valid values. So if the browser is not supporting the env function, it will ignore it and it will keep the previous one. Anyway, just something that is, I mean, it's not so important to be honest, but if you're doing PWA, sometimes we will find this problem. Devices with a notch. When they have a notch, also you have the problem of safe areas, but we can solve that with safe areas. The problem is that when you go landscape, the problem is that by default, the viewport goes only in the safe area. And what you see here will be your background color, okay, that you define in the manifest. But if you have an image, the image is not taking the whole width. Does it make sense? Well, to solve the problem, I mean, because your content is only there, so your body in CSS is that one. The rest is outside of your viewport, outside of your canvas. You cannot render content, only on landscape, okay? Only on landscape. So that's why you can ask for cover viewport and then use safe areas to, again, add those margins. What is cover viewport? It's just an addition that you add to your viewport meta tag. It's viewport fit cover. In this case, you are saying, you know what? I want to take always 100% of the viewport, even if it's not safe. I don't care. Okay. But I want to have 100% of the canvas. So when you do that, then now your content will take the whole available space. And the problem if you do that is that by default, now if you are rendering a calculator, that calculator is behind the notch. To solve the problem, you add margins using the safe areas we mentioned before.